Hi, friends. I'm Emily Lay, and you're listening to the Simplified Podcast. If you need a few minutes to filter out the noise and the hustle, this is it. You're in the right place. Every week, I invite you to slow down and explore how to organize and automate the complicated parts of life so you can focus on what truly matters most. If you're looking for some gentle guidance on thinking about different areas of your life, like friendship, finances, meal planning, and so much more, you have to check out our new collection of workbooks over at emilylay.com. Each workbook is designed to help you dive a little more deeply into a practice you'd like to be a bit more intentional about, all wrapped up in a beautiful workbook package. Reviewer Jessica B. said our faith workbook, "This is hands down my favorite faith-themed journal I have ever owned. Once again, Simplified and Emily Lay have helped me be intentional in my days." I love that so much. It means so, so, so much to us to hear that. You can find your favorite new workbook today over at emilylay.com. So as I sit down to record this podcast, one of the things running through my head is, I don't know if I want to go there. I'm not sure if I want to go there. If you've ever struggled into a pair of jeans that used to slide on with ease, then you know. If you've ever weighed your portions and put them in small containers so you could put some shackles on your appetite, then you know. If you've ever sat on the edge of the bathtub, heartbroken to see another test that says, not pregnant, then you know. If you've ever wanted her hair or her skin, if you've ever wanted to move around without a chair, without restrictions, without any obstacles in your way to accessing a normal life that so many have, then you know. And this time of year doesn't help. Everywhere you turn, there's messages telling you that this is your year. This is the magical time where you can shrink in order to matter a little bit more. This is the time when you make yourself into a prettier package that others will like more and you will like more. The messages say, this is the able, thin, sparkling body you need to have in order to receive more love and more belonging. The messages are so loud, they seem to drown out everything else. But listen to me, dear one. You are worthy of love and belonging just as you are. Your body, the one who's listening to me right now, probably while she's multitasking a few things on her plate, she is beautiful. Not in the trite, we're all winners kind of way. She is a gorgeous miracle. I'm not sure how it makes you feel to hear those words about yourself. If I'm honest, when someone compliments me, sometimes I'll do everything in my power to tell them why those words aren't true. Because if I can say that's not true before someone else does, then it's not going to hurt so bad. That's a small sliver of a big problem we've been fighting for a long time. But here's the thing. Loving your body just as she is right now is a lifelong battle. I wish I could give you a silver bullet to take away all the struggle you have, but my hope is that you begin to really see the way you think about yourself, that you really see the way you talk about yourself. I hope that when you look in the mirror and start picking yourself apart, the small, still voice that speaks truth over you tells you, no, that is not who you are. You are beautiful. You are strong. You are a gorgeous miracle. Maybe if we say it enough times, it won't take any effort to believe it. And that is what I hope for you. And that's what my guest today hopes for you too. I am beyond excited that my friend Jess Connolly is on the show today. Jess is an author and a coach who's written 9 outstanding books. Her latest one is called Breaking Free from Body Shame. And let me tell you, it is so good. I knew I had to have her on the show today because Jess has dedicated the past couple years to thinking about how to heal the shame we have about our bodies. She is an excellent teacher here, and I hope you enjoy her as much as I do. So with that, here is my conversation with Jess Connolly.
Jess, hi. I'm so happy to have you here. You are one of my favorite people. I love following you on Instagram because I feel like whenever I see something from you pop up, I'm like, this is what I need. I always know it's going to be like, you go there. It's going to be what I need. And I don't often get that from Instagram. Yeah. So thanks for being that and for using Instagram like that. It just fills me up a little bit.
Same. I feel the exact same way about you. I'm like, my favorite thing about you on the internet is that you break like every mold that I think someone would want to put you in.
Stop. That's so
in scary. The best ways. In the best ways. Like, I think it and it's what women need to see. They need to see women who are good at planning and strategizing and also have so much heart and soul and humility. And that's who you are. I'm so grateful for you.
That's the nicest compliment I've gotten all year. Seriously. I like breaking out of mold. So thank you for saying that. That's very sweet.
Yeah. Yeah.
Well, let's talk about this. So as an author, so you're an author, I'm an author. You've written nine mm-hmm. books. Nine? Is that right? Nine?
Yeah. Yeah.
That's a lot of books.
You count Bible studies too. Yeah.
That's amazing though. And I love all of your books, but your most recent book, Breaking Free from Body Shame, is something that I remember when you announced that you were putting it out there and that this is what your next book was going to be about. And I remember thinking, like, she's going there. Like, she is going there. Like, this is a topic that every woman thinks about. We all think about our bodies. We all struggle with our bodies. We all have thoughts and feelings about what they should be or should not be, how they're serving us or not serving us. And I remember seeing that you were going to put this out, and I was like, this is going to be one that I'm really excited to read. So what, as an author, like, you could have picked a whole lot of topics to write about, but what made mm-hmm. you decide to dig into like that topic and that part of your life, your journey?
The reason why it was the right material for me to write is because I genuinely experienced healing. And I'm probably, I'd say, like 4, 5, 6 years out from like this transformative process that I went through where I genuinely love my body. And I think, you know, a year or two in it, it had the novelty to it of, I was like, this is beautiful. I don't feel all these disordered things I used to feel before. But some of that began to wear off. And I actually forgot for a season that most women hate their bodies. And so I think I was just kind of living in this bubble of healing and freedom. So that being said, the reason why the content was right for me is because I just can genuinely tell women, you know, I struggle with an autoimmune disease. I'm very curvy. I'm not your like average standard of beauty, you know, for whatever culture is writing about it right now, but I genuinely love my body. I feel at home in my body. I feel free in my body. Yeah. And so that's the number one reason why I was right. But the timing was right. And when I wrote the book, I started writing in April 2020, and the timing was right really just because I started seeing all of these jokes online about what our bodies were going to be like after the pandemic. And I think that brought it to my forefront, the forefront of my mind, really, of like, oh, we are collectively about to distrust our bodies, hate our bodies, and kind of like publicly malign our bodies.
Wow.
And
you're right.
Yeah. So actually, yeah, I started seeing like the memes pop up in the first few weeks, and I was like, I can't do that. I can't do this.
Right.
I can't be a part of this conversation for the next year. So I actually wasn't supposed to write a book in 2020, but my editor called me one day and she said, I'd actually already written the first chapter of the book after a meeting with her one day, but she called me and she said, how do you think women are feeling about their bodies right now? And I said, I think they're feeling pretty busted.
Yeah.
And she was like, You want to ride? You want to do this thing?
You want to ride?
Like, yeah.
Are you in? I get that. I had my own journey through all that with the pandemic, and I'm not the same size I was before it, and I beat myself up a little bit about it. So what for you personally? Like, I know you've kind of been on this fitness journey, right? Like you have. I don't know. It was just so beautiful to like watch you go through that and watch you approach it in a really like healthy way. I in the past have approached fitness in like a punish myself kind of a way. And I also have autoimmune stuff. And so I totally get all of that. And I get trying to like fix it, right? Like my body is broken. My body doesn't work right. So I'm going to fix it. I'm going to force it into where it's supposed to be by eating certain things and making myself work out certain amounts of time. Like, what did that journey look like for you going from maybe having some of those feelings to getting to a place where you are like, okay, like this is who I'm meant to be. And this is beautiful.
Yeah. I love that question, Emily. And it's interesting, as many interviews as I've done about the book, I don't think anyone's asked me in quite that way. And it's actually a piece that I really am eager to share. So yeah, if anybody has been following me on the internet for any amount of time, I've had a fitness journey. That's exactly what I would say. I've had a journey with fitness. I was like a casual runner. I'd started to run maybe in like 2009, had started to like try to figure out if I could run. Before that, pre-2009, I had no athletic anything. Like I never exercised. I did not belong to any kind of a gym, nothing like that. Except for brief periods of specifically, I struggled with exercise anorexia in college. It's one of the issues that I struggled with. And so outside of that season, I was not an exerciser. And so I started running in 2009, at the encouragement of my therapist at the time. Yeah. And I would run for a little bit and take a few years off and run for a little bit and take a few years off. And my youngest son was born in 2013. And about a year after he was born, I wanted freedom. I really genuinely, I recognized I have all this freedom in these other parts of my life. Yeah. I feel calling and purpose and hope and vision, but I don't feel it in my body. Mm-hmm. And so for me, genuinely starting to feel free enough to move my body in a more athletic way was one of the first places where I experienced a little bit of hope and a little bit of flavor and excitement. So yeah. I started running more. I started training for half marathons and a full marathon. I became a bar instructor. I started doing like aerial yoga for fun.
It's so fun. I've done it too.
It's so fun. It's the most fun. And I think a lot of that for me was about fighting defeat, about saying like, I am not going to live under this label of not being an athletic girl or not being a girl who can move. Now, the reason why I love that you ask it, because nobody's really actually asked it in that way. So here's what's interesting. Yeah. I weigh the exact number that I have weighed for the last 9 years.
Yeah.
I've trained for a marathon. I've ran a marathon. I've become a bar instructor. I've lifted weights. I've done aerial yoga. I've been a walker. I've been a runner. I've done Pilates. Like, I've done it all. Yeah. I weigh the exact same.
Like, this same thing happened to me. I worked out with a personal trainer for years and weighed the exact, but inside, I was totally different.
It's so different. Yeah. And people will tell me all the time, you are in the best shape of your life. And I'll be like, joke's on you.
Joke's on you. Same. Joke's on you. Same jeans.
Yeah. But I know I look free because I feel free.
Yeah.
And so that has been the biggest transformation for me in realizing I could be a girl who moves my body. I can even be the girl at the front of the class, you know, taking a bunch of 20-year-olds through a fitness class.
Yeah.
And I'm free. Yeah. And I'm free to do that. And so, yeah, it has actually been a huge part of my journey, but not in that my body's changed.
That is so fascinating because I had the same experience. People would be like, you look great. You look amazing. You must be working out a lot. And I was like, I am. But the scale never moved. Never. But I looked at the scale like, if you go down, I am worthy. I am more worthy. Like I am a better version of Emily. If that would just go down, I'm a better. And when it goes up, and I was at the point, like at one point in my life, I weighed myself every day, twice a day in the morning when I woke up.
Yeah.
Before I went to bed. And it would dictate like, well, here's the kind of day you're going to have. And here's what you're going to be able to do. And like finding my worth in that thing. I mean, I've been around the block.
Yeah. So interesting. You know, I mean, so when I was writing Breaking Free, I had like the first conversation I ever had with someone like outside of, I'd say like my husband about it. Mm-hmm. And someone told me, they said, you know, you don't look any different. but you look like you feel beautiful.
Yeah.
And I said, ding, ding, ding. Like, you got it. I do feel beautiful. I do feel good about my body. And it's also been one of the really interesting things that I didn't anticipate, I probably should have, mm-hmm. about the book coming out, is because I've been like upfront about my autoimmune disorder, and because I've been upfront about, you know, how I feel about my body, I didn't expect, but I should have, so many people to maybe like DM me or slide in my inbox and say, I can fix this.
Like, oh my gosh.
Fix you.
Oh my gosh.
Yeah. But like, we could get the scale to budge. So I just want to say out loud as a disclaimer for anyone who's listening, who's like maybe a trainer or a nutritionist and who says like, oh wait, I know your disease. Like, I could do this. I actually, if anybody's wondering, I actually do know what I could do too. Like, I know how I could make the scale move. I know what I could do. It's just not free for me. It's living in bondage. And I just can't do it anymore.
Yeah. That I absolutely love that. Like, I can remember having that conversation with my husband where I was kind of struggling with thoughts about like, I should be a certain size and I'm not anymore or whatever. And I remember saying like, when I try to be that number, I have to work really, really hard to be that number.
Yeah.
And when I'm the number I am now, like, I don't feel the pressure. I feel happy. I feel like I'm making choices not to like meet a number, but like to fuel and nourish and that sort of thing, which is just a much healthier mindset for someone. I tend to go like all in on all the things, you know? So I'm either like 112% in or I'm totally out. So that just felt healthier. What does it like tactically look like for you? Like, if someone's listening to this and they're like, I don't feel free. I feel stuck worrying so much about what I'm putting in my mouth, about how I'm moving my body, about what, you know, the number on the scale says, or that I don't look like her on social media or whatever. Mm-hmm. What do they do? Like, what's the first step to get from there where they are to where they want to be?
I'm so glad you asked, because we got to talk about it practically.
Yeah.
Sometimes there's some leftover injuries that are some thought patterns or some behaviors that have just been there for decades for a lot of us, that I just say in all compassion, we didn't start this fight. Like, we didn't ask for it.
Right.
You know, we didn't do something wrong to make ourselves struggle with body image. We were born into this.
Yep.
And so I just have so much compassion for any woman who's like, hey, this is going to be a process for me.
Yeah.
I would say like, absolutely. Yeah. That being said, some logistical things I would say, one of the first things I would just massively encourage women to do is detox any shame that is coming into them from a variety of ways, either by what they see or by what they hear, by what they read, by media they consume, and even like what they experience in their own personal life. So this is as big as like unfollowing accounts on Instagram that really aid and abet in the objectification of women.
Yep.
You know, things where we're seeing women just number one, like maybe not valued well, or also like proposed in some image that's just not realistic at all.
Right.
So begin to detox yourself from that. But then I would also say this is also as small and as important as taking the jeans out of your closet that have been there for 20 years that no longer fit. That every time you open the closet, you're like, I'm a mess, you know?
Yeah.
Detoxing those things from your life, because it's going to be so hard to kind of get at the heart of shame if you're continually inputting it at the same time.
Like a daily dose. Daily dose of shame every time I'm in my closet. Yeah.
Yeah, absolutely. Mm-hmm. So I would say begin to detox that. I would say after that, logistically, another thing that is an actual game changer is changing your language. You cannot control how other people around you talk, but you absolutely can control. We each have control over our own mouths. Yeah. So make some declaration, draw a line in the sand and say, from here on out, I don't talk negatively about my body. I certainly don't talk negatively about other people's bodies. And I'm not going to consent to conversations where my body's talked about negatively.
Yeah.
So I would say that's like another logistical thing that is doable. It's actionable and we can actually fix it. Mm-hmm. And then again, there are a million other things I would encourage, but the last one that if I could just encourage women to think through is kind of like follow the fun, find the delight.
Oh, and I love that.
Begin to learn to access. Yeah. Like what you like to do in your body. What do you like to eat? How do you like to move? What makes you feel alive? Mm-hmm. And begin to think less about what you need to cut out and think more about how you can just follow that, follow the actual things you desire and crave.
I love that. That's kind of been a mind shift for me lately is like, you know, I tried to take on certain workout routines. Working out for me, exercising, it's like an anti-anxiety help, if you will. And it helps me process things and just feel better. And, you know, I tried lots of different things, but I didn't like them. And I thought like, well, I should just keep going because everybody else likes to do these things. But meanwhile, it wasn't fun. And then I found like just going for like a run or a walk around my neighborhood. Like, I love that. I have so much fun doing it. And the same can be said for what you eat, you know, like finding the things that you like that are nutritious and fuel you and that kind of thing. It really is like coming at things from the top down rather than the bottom up, if that makes sense.
Yes.
It changes it.
Yeah. If you don't like kale, don't eat kale. Like, for goodness sake, don't. Your life is too short.
Yeah.
If you don't like Pilates, do not do Pilates. Don't do it one more time. Your life is too precious.
You can make choices. Yeah. That's so true.
But do find what you love. Do find the foods that make you feel alive, whether that's ice cream or butternut squash. And, you know, and find the movement and find a way to experience being in your body in a way that makes you feel more alive, that helps you feel more joy.
Yeah. That is so good. I look back at pictures of myself when I was actively going through serious like body image stuff and mm-hmm. weird eating patterns. And just, I look back at pictures of me and I can see like you were the number you wanted to be, but inside mm-hmm. like you weren't happy. And you were doing all these things just to like be this number or this size or wear this certain pair of jeans and you, but they didn't make you happy at all. You know, it made you thrilled with a number, but what is that, you know, at the end of the day? And I feel like I can look at myself now and be like, you're not that number, but good gracious, you're so much more free and so much more happy inside, you know? And it is, it's like the, you feel more beautiful. Which I just think, I don't know. I think that's lovely. Another thing, and this, I could probably have a whole entire like hour long conversation with you about this particular topic, but you and I both have daughters and mm-hmm. I have a lot of feelings about my daughter and like, I don't want her to go through the hard stuff I've gone through, but I know she will because she's female and she lives in this world. And mm-hmm. I try to be really cognizant about like, you know, not just saying like, Caroline, you're so pretty. She's so pretty. But I don't want to just be like, you're so pretty today. You look so pretty. I tried to tell her things like, you put together such a great outfit. I love that it, you know, reflects your personality or whatever, like wording things in a different way. But do you have any advice on how we can guide our girls to adopt healthy images or healthy views of their bodies, even if we as moms struggle?
Yeah, such a good question. And here is the best news. I pray if any moms are listening who are like, it's me. Like I have a daughter or I have a son and I really struggle here. And I feel like I already feel bad about it or I already feel burdened about it. The best news is truly, I believe this with all that I've got is that the moms who really wrestle through this themselves for themselves have such a unique opportunity to lead their children in a really compelling way. And here's why, because when moms change their minds, and specifically when moms say they're sorry and they like turn and go a different way, the entire family experiences renewal and revival. Truly.
So true. Retweet. That's true.
Yeah. You know, think about how powerful it is when you go to your kids and say, like, listen, I was wrong. I'm sorry.
Yeah. Shocking to them.
Shocking.
Did that last
so night. For any so for any moms who are like, I'm in it. I talk about my body negatively all the time. I talk about my kids' bodies negatively. Yeah. Great news. You absolutely can stop. Mm-hmm. And when you tell your kids, like, I am sorry, I have done this wrong. I want to honor my body. I want to honor your body. I want to speak life over us. The world will change. Your actual whole world will change. And so you're in a really great space. But that being said, practically, truly, I think one of the best ways we can serve our daughters and our sons is by living out our personal freedom in front of them.
I was hoping you would say that. That is game-changing. Yeah. Game-changing.
It's a game-changer. So I think, like, do you need to have sit-down conversations with your kids about body shame, you know, once a month? I don't know that you need to. Yeah. Do you need to be ready to help them think through tense conversations or when they feel bad? Absolutely. But living out your own freedom in front of them, being the mom who will eat ice cream with them, you know, on July 4th, but also letting them see you try new things. And that's it. That's one of the most powerful pieces of impact I think we can have with our kids.
I agree. A couple of months ago, I had to have surgery to repair an umbilical hernia that I got from being pregnant with two babies at one time. And
yeah.
I have a pretty big vertical scar on my stomach, and I was in a swimsuit or I was getting dressed or something, and Caroline was in my room, and I remember her turning around and seeing it, and it was, at the time, like, it was pretty obvious, and she kind of looked at it, and she looked at me, and it was kind of like, what do we think about this, you know? And I remember having that moment and having read your book, and I remember thinking, like, we're going to talk about why this is beautiful, because this is my story. Like, and so I got down on her level and I was like, Caroline, this little scar, it's almost like, so we call scars angel kisses in our house. And I was like, this is my little angel
kiss. I love it.
This is my angel kiss that I got from having two babies in my belly. And do you know how much I prayed for those two babies that God put in there? And I had to have surgery to repair it. And this is just the mark that's there from it. But it's beautiful because it's part of me and it's part of how I got you. And we just talked about it in, like, a positive way. And she was like, cool, moving on. Like, on to the next thing.
I love it.
And it just, like, I think flipping things around like that and realizing, like, oh my gosh, number one, they're listening. And number two, like, they are internalizing and digesting all the words that come out of our mouths, because what we say becomes their inner voice eventually.
Yeah.
You know?
Absolutely. Absolutely. And again, just massive doses of freedom to anyone who's like, I've done it wrong. It's okay. Oh, it's not too late. 100%. If your kids are 50, call them up, you know, and say, okay, I made a mistake here. I think I may have talked negatively about my body. I may have even talked negatively about your body. I'd like to try again.
Yeah.
And that's a game changer.
It's always a big deal when a mom can turn around and say, like, you know what? I made a mistake there and I'm sorry.
Yeah.
Mom got real frustrated and raised her voice last night. And I eventually was like, you know what? Mommy kind of had a little bit of a rough day antics tonight put me over the edge a little bit, and I'm sorry. I should have used a different tone or whatever. But and they look at you like, really? So I do. I think that's so important. Well,
thank
you so much for doing this with me today. I think this conversation is so important, and I'm so glad that you are making space for us to have honest conversations about it, because it matters not just for us, but for all the girls coming up behind us too.
Yeah, absolutely. Thank you for having this conversation. I'm so grateful for you.
Absolutely. You guys, Jess is such a fantastic teacher, isn't she? If you guys have never met her, I am so glad that you know her now. I think my biggest takeaway from our conversation is what a transformation it makes when you truly feel beautiful, no matter your body. I just think that's so powerful, so powerful. I've experienced that and I've seen it in other people. And I just think that that is such a good nugget of information to take away. As we close out this episode, I would like to say a blessing for you as we leave this time together and get back into our days.
May you remember that you are worthy of love and belonging just as you are right now. May your body continue to be a force for love in a world that is hungry for it. And may you remember that God only makes good things, and you, my dear, are so good. As always, I like to leave a little tip to help you put what we've talked about today into practice. I'm not sure if the term simplicity tip applies to what I'm telling you today. Anything that has to do with our body image rarely feels simple, but for today, I want you to start calling your body she. Here's what I mean. When you say something like, my body is so tired today, or my body is so sore, or even something like, my body doesn't move like it used to, replace it with the word she. She is so tired today. She is so sore. She doesn't move like she used to. Do you hear the difference? You've just given your body an identity. You've given her importance and made her more human and more lovable by declaring her the living, breathing thing that she is, that you are. This is something I learned from Dr. Hilary McBride, who's another expert in healing the shame we have around our bodies. If this is a subject you would like to learn more about, go and check her out. Thank you for listening to the Simplified Podcast. I hope today's episode helped you remember what a gorgeous miracle your body is, just as she is right now. You can find show notes for this episode at emilylay.com/podcast, where you can check out links and resources I mentioned here, and you can shop the Simplified brand of planners and products. Plus, for more simplicity tips, you can find me on Instagram at emilylay and at simplified. If you're loving this show, then I bet you might love my latest book called Growing Boldly, Dare to Build a Life You Love, which is in stores right now wherever you buy books. One last thing, I love bringing you this show each week. If you're loving it as much as I do, would you do me a quick favor? Would you go over to your podcast provider and rate the show or even leave a review? This is a small thing that helps our show in really big ways. It tells your podcast provider to put this show in the hands of more listeners who might enjoy some of these helpful tips and tricks as well. I really appreciate your help. Until next time, thank you so much for listening. Bye.